Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this special seminar today. It's part of a workshop on campus, but also part of something that the Princeton Environmental Institute is putting on this semester that we call a seminar series around challenges in environmental sciences. And what we tried to do is to bring in people we consider to be thought leaders in their own fields to hear what they have to say and to impart wisdom on us as we think in PEI about things we might want to do. And it's really a pleasure for me to introduce today's speaker in the seminar series, who is Professor Ruben Juanes. Ruben is the ARCO Professor of Engineering Studies, a Professor of Civil and Environmental Engineering, and the Director of the Henry Pierce Laboratory for Infrastructure Science and Engineering, all at MIT. Ruben has his undergraduate degree from Spain. He then did a master's and PhD at UC Berkeley. He spent, I believe, 3 years at Stanford in a really creative kind of postdoc position there, and more or less since then has been at MIT. For my reading, Ruben does absolutely fantastic work on a broad range of problems associated with fluid flows in porous media, and more broadly in fluid mechanics and also solid mechanics. And this includes things like fundamental work on carbon sequestration, methane hydrates, fractured rocks and fractures in soils, and ecohydrology and unstable flows in unsaturated soil zones, some of which he will tell us about today, I believe, based on his title. He's received a number of awards, including an early career award from the Department of Energy, and more recently, an award for outstanding contributions in geosciences across the Department of Energy. So please join me in welcoming our good friend, Ruben.
Thank you so much, Mike, for the extremely kind introduction. I'm delighted to be here. This is normally what one says at the beginning of a talk. And it's true most of the time. It is particularly true this time. I'm delighted to be here as invited by Karina Tarnita and Rob Pringle and Simon Levine for a workshop that they have organized. Fabulous start today. And then also by my good old friend Mike Cilia, being a speaker for this seminar series. It's a true honor, and I'm again delighted to be back in Princeton. I don't think I will be imparting much wisdom, because to impart it, you have to have it. So that's probably not going to happen today. But I will try to make good on the promise of talking about some instability that lead to pattern formation. So I hope to at least be able to cover some of that. Of course, as we all know, my name is here at the top and I'm delivering this talk, but you know, not the one doing the work. So listed here are a few of the PhD students and postdocs who are responsible for the work that I will be discussing. And really, credit goes to them, and the blame comes to me, whatever, anything is not correct. So this is a workshop on pattern formation. So I thought I would start with, what is pattern formation? And why not start with an apology? So pattern formation is the formation of patterns. So we're on safe grounds there. I don't think that would be too controversial. And they can be regular or irregular, right? So meaning we're still not saying much. And of course I could be showing slide after slide of examples of patterns that occur in nature. But I thought that I would present a few of them. For instance, columns in basalt, or cracks in soil, or as we'll discuss in a bit more detail, fingering patterns of water infiltrating in the unsaturated zone. So those tend to be fairly regular, but they're also very regular ones. No? So you see this dendritic pattern in Rock. So in geoscience, I will make a case that often the origin of these patterns is an instability. So that can arise.
So it seems like a strange thing to say, but the one on the lower right was rather regular, so you call it irregular.
The lower right.
This only irregular horizontal, it's just like from pattern to pattern in that structure.
Oh, so it
maybe
is.
That's just,
so it has structure. Like one can have, for instance, a fractal structure. So as you zoom in, you see details, but when you blow them up, look the same. By regular, I guess I'll be referring to that they will have an organization on a lattice, on some kind of
repeated.
Yeah. So from that point of view, this one would not fall in that category. But see, I mean, there's nothing you can say that would not be controversial. Not even. Pattern formation is the formation of patterns.
I didn't respond to that.
so even when the origin is an instability, you have different kinds of different classes. For instance, you can have an instability that arises from a uniform state, so you can think of it as a phase separation process, or you can think of an instability that arises from a front that is perfectly uniform to begin with, and then it becomes disordered, or it loses its uniformity. So it is that second kind of this front instability kind that I will be paying most of devoting most of my time to. As I said, most of our work relates to fluid flows in porous medium. So if we restrict ourselves to that realm, then we can have instabilities from fluid-fluid displacement so that the porous medium itself, the skeleton, does not deform. It is passive from the point of view of the instability. So I will be referring to those as fingering instabilities, because a front becomes unstable and it's as if a dendrite, fingers were emerging from it. But if the medium itself deforms, it can do so in a variety of ways. In particular, it can open up forming fractures. And we can study instabilities in a number of ways. Sometimes what we're interested in is determining the conditions under which the instability appears. So that sometimes can be done with a linear stability analysis. But that sometimes, but often not, will tell us something about the pattern itself. Because the emergence of the pattern and the evolution of the pattern falls squarely in the nonlinear region. So we have to deal with the nonlinearities of those interactions responsible for them. Okay, so when it comes to instabilities, there are a number of forces that can cause them. For instance, gravity, density differences, or viscosity differences. And I will make the distinction between instabilities that arise in miscible fluid systems, so think of alcohol and water. You can mix them in all proportions, as many of us know. And the instability can be caused, again, by density differences. If you have a layer of a denser fluid on top, that leads to an unstable configuration. Or by viscosity differences, if you try to push a low viscosity fluid into a high viscosity. And these instabilities have their counterpart for immiscible fluids. So think of air and water. A little bit of the air will dissolve in water, and a little bit of the water will vaporize into air. But for many of the textbooks that we're interested in, those two fluids can be considered to be immiscible. But we still have this type of instability. So the difference between, and these are the results of simulation. But there's a sort of difference that I'd like to stress and emphasize as the talk proceeds, and that is that these simulations come from solving traditional equations. These simulations do not. I mean, we don't have sort of the classical traditional equations describing immiscible, unstable flows of porous medium. So, to make the point, I think, clear, I thought I chose this slide showing an experiment. This is an experiment, very simple. You have a box, you fill it with glass beads, right? And you compact them with the glass beads. And then you put the box very clean, and then you fill it from the bottom with one dense fluid, for instance, water. And then you tilt the box so that you have initially a vertical interface. But, well, water is denser than, okay, then once you, sorry, I described this the other way, you fill it with a dense fluid, in this case glycerol, and then you fill it with water. And because they are, you do it carefully enough, but fast enough that these two fluids, which are miserably not proportional, will not mix. And then you tilt the box 90 degrees, and you let the system evolve. And because water is less dense, well, it will rise up. And glycerol is more dense, and it will spill down. And this is exactly what you would expect. You have a gravity current forming with the lighter fluid on top of the denser fluid. So now we repeat this experiment, but with two immiscible fluids. So we have water as a denser fluid and just simply air as the lighter fluid. And we record what happens. And well, of course, the air runs up and the water runs down. But they seem to be different in a substantial way with respect to the miscible case, right? So you have a vertical interface here, and this vertical interface will remain there forever. I still have some of these experiments in my office, okay, 8 years after the experiment, still with the vertical interface sitting there. So,
what is the depth of the
interface? About 1 centimeter. And the beads are in the order of 1 to 2 millimeter beads. Okay, so this is just to make the point that there's a big difference between miscible and immiscible flows, and we're talking about immiscible. So of course, one can sort of zoom in conceptually and understand why this is happening. And this brings about one key aspect of immiscible flows, and that is surface tension. The fact that the pressure across an interface doesn't have to be continuous. Right? So whenever you have a curved interface, there will be a pressure difference. For air to penetrate, it has to squeeze through two of these posts. So there will be a curvature that is required for that to happen. And the inverse of that curvature is the pressure difference. For water to displace air, on the other hand, you don't need to squeeze through anything, you just need to bridge across these posts. So the curvature that is required is different. So without any sort of hysteresis in the contact angle or anything, just even with perfect wetting, you can see that these two pressures are different. And therefore, there's a gravitational difference that has to account for. Okay. So that is one important concept that is at the heart of invisible fluid displacements. The other one is wettability, or the fact that the substrate that the porous medium is made of can be wetting to one of the fluids or can be non-wetting. And the fact that wettability plays an important role in invisible flows has been recognized for a very long time. This comes from some classic experiments by Stokes and Dave Waits, when it used to be at ExxonMobil. In illustrating precisely this. So these are experiments also with a glass bead pack in which a dense viscous fluid oil is displaced by a low viscosity fluid, in this case water, leading to an unstable flow. So there is immiscible viscous fingering. But in this top thing, the displacing fluid is non-wet. And the instability, the width of the instability, is of the same order as the grain size. If we make the displacing fluid wetting, then the the width of the instability is much larger than the grade size. So this is, again, just direct evidence that wettability plays an important role. And this is something that, you know, we've taken an interest on in trying to understand well, how that happens and what the ramifications are. Using simple experiments. So the experimental setup is illustrated here. It's just a frame. You fill it with glass beads. You put a lid on top, and then you inject. And you choose the fluid that you want in order to have control over the wettability properties. And in that way, we can have a range of wetting properties from drainage to imbibition. Drainage meaning that the fluid that we inject is non-wetting, tries to stay away from the glass beads. Imbibition meaning that the fluid we inject has an affinity for the glass beads. And you can see what a range of patterns, which is what was advertised. So the drainage conditions are very well understood. And this is in a way we were just sort of checking that we were doing things right. When we inject slowly, we have something akin to capillary fingering or invasion percolation. And as we increase the injection rate, then we progressively move towards viscous fingering. Or in the analogy has been made many times in the statistical physics term, DLA process, diffusion limited aggregation. But you can see that as we vary the wetting conditions from drainage to imbibition, those patterns change, and in particular, we thicken the, we retain the instability, and the fingers themselves are wider. And we can reach some extreme conditions in which if we inject slowly enough, and if the fluid that we inject is wetting, we remove the instability altogether. Even though the fluid that we inject is, in this case, something like 400 times less viscous. But because of the pore scale physics that will become apparent in just a moment, the cooperative nature of fluid invasion, in this case, will take away the instability that we see in drainage configuration. So, but you can say, well, this is a complicated process. We have a porous medium, a porous medium is complex, so how do we know, what is this really telling us? And this is one of the examples that I've been using for some time now, for how some seemingly very simple things are still lying there right in front of us. So Denis Bartolot and his people decided to revisit the Safman-Taylor problem, which is a very simple problem. You have two glass plates, thin gap between them, and you just blow air to displace a viscous fingering. And what emerges is one single finger that occupies about half the width of the channel. And they decided to do just that by changing the wetting property so that the fluid that you inject, in this case it's water, is strongly wetting to the substrate, strongly wetting to the two plates. And what they found was that the water image was very different from the classical Safman-Taylor thing, very different. In particular, they discovered, and they really discovered, the formation of these thin films ahead of the main finger. So this is just to send a message that even in extremely simple configurations, I don't think you can find a simpler configuration, just a channel, flat channel, wettability plays an important role. So in some recent work, we try to strike a balance between the simplicity of a single straight channel and the complexity of a rather opaque porous medium, just with a microfluidic chip, where we have very good control, very precise control over the geometry and the wetting properties. I'd love to tell you about the fabrication procedure, which we borrowed from Michael Lowe, by the way. But I don't have time for that now. But the configuration is very simple. You have these patterned microfluidic chip with posts, and now we're going to inject one fluid to displace another. And the benefit is that we can image this quantitatively. We can really image what is happening at the level of the hosts and at the level of individual interfaces. So collectively, this is what we get. Right? So I mean, this makes for sort of for a nice poster if you're into these things. I'm not asking you to be excited about these things, but I am. So the first thing that you notice, I'm going to make three very quick observations. The first one is that you see a range of colors. So that is not cosmetic. So there's a scale here that refers to the, locally, the fraction of the width, fraction of the gap, that is filled by the fluid we inject. So whenever we see very bright color, this whitish here, that means that the entire gap is filled with the invading fluid. Whenever we see the dark color, black, the fluid has not gotten there. And whenever we see some of these reddish, orangey color, it means that only a fraction, a small fraction of the gap, is filled with invading fluid. So that's the first observation, that high capillary numbers, when we inject fast enough, only a fraction of the gap is filled. The second observation is that we indeed see this compactification of the pattern as we go from drainage, that is, the fluid that we inject is non-vacuum, to inhibition. And the reason is that in inhibition, in weak inhibition, one interface pulls from its neighbor. So you have this cooperative filling that ultimately is responsible for this rather stable pattern that emerges. Up to a point, so really it took us a while to figure this out as we were putting together this puzzle. This column over here didn't quite match, right? So we were expecting that, well, we would see even more RAM a pattern over here, but that was not the case. So it took us a while to figure out what was happening. What was happening was that the mode of displacement at the pore scale was entirely different. We were no longer invading sort of the pores between the posts. What was happening instead, I draw your attention to here to the left pane, what was happening instead was this. The invading fluid is now so wet to the substrate that it's coating the individual posts and then jumping from one post to the next. If we inject fast enough, this happens in a rather continuous way. The reason being that the time that it takes to coat an individual post is comparable to the time that it takes to deliver the fluid. But if we inject very slowly, that is no longer the case. And what we see is a set of avalanches that is reminiscent, again, of an invasion percolation process, only that now instead of filling posts, we're coating posts. Or instead of filling pores, we're coating posts.
Normally, you never quite told us, but normally you define a capillary number in terms of a speed.
Yes.
So here it's a radial front, and you'd expect the speed to change with where you are.
Yes.
Is that?
So that is correct, yes. And that is something that we have to deal with because we favor radial geometries. We favor radial geometries because the results that we get are...
Well, no, I'm not critical, but then I don't compare...
But you could be critical, right? So I agree that the capillary number would be time-dependent. So we don't make it time-dependent, we just define the capillary number as something that is proportional to the injection. So there's a rationale to do it, but it is essentially defined by the velocity around the injection point. So of course that is not necessarily representative of what is happening later in the process. It is not. But I think it is fair in terms of comparing different experiments, different capillary. So even if the magnitudes
I guess what I'm confused by is, on the previous slide, the two axes are capillary number and wetting.
Yes.
But normally, I mean, if you work on a boundary line, you probably, you might think that the wetting parameter came in anywhere you have the surface tension.
Yes.
So you might expect that there was some way to incorporate the wetting angle and the surface tension, but then that would say what's your other axis, and that suggests that the another parameter is when you have a tension, kind of how far hard you have to push to get the fluid in the system in the first place.
Yeah, so if we had an answer to that question, I think we would publish another paper. And that is, you're absolutely right. So can we actually collapse these two axes? Because clearly we have surface tension and contact angle. Both of them are entangled in defining the pressure across an interface. So we have not been able to collapse these results in any successful way. And it could be one of two things, but it's probably that we're not smart enough. But you're absolutely right, yes. There would be, there should be some collapse if we could find the right scale.
Yep.
Okay, so in these processes, it is the interaction of one fluid with another that determines the pattern. But the medium itself can, in principle, deform, right? So instead of just squeezing through the pores or coating through the grains, we can also open up our own conduits. And this can be, again, this can be thought of conceptually at the grain scale by defining forces on the grains, right? And these forces will come from the bulk fluids, accounting for the difference in pressure. And it will come from the extra addition that comes from the contact line at the grain interfaces. So one can again rationalize what is competing with what. So there are some forces acting in the direction of opening up grains, and those will be viscous forces and capillary forces. And there will be forces resisting any grain motion, and those are, it could be cementation between grains, or a friction between grains. So in the system that I will be discussing, we didn't have any cementation between the grains, so it is all due to friction. And we can control the friction by varying the amount of confining stress that we put in the system. So there will be a capillary number, so this is the capillary number that we are using. It's proportional to the injection rate that we use. And we can measure this balance between forces opening up of conduits versus forces resisting that conduit opening in the form of a fracturing. So this is the form that that dimensionless parameter takes. And we could convince at least ourselves and three reviewers that that this allowed us to understand what was going on. And I still feel that the result is interesting, because if the fracturing number is very small, the medium is rigid. So we do observe this transition from capillary fingering to viscous fingering, as we would expect. But as the fracturing number increases, we transition from either one to a fracturing regime in which we are opening up conduits. And that can happen even at vanishingly small injection rates. So really, capillarity is doing all the work. So this is why we call this hydrocapillary fracturing, as opposed to just simply hydraulic fracturing, which relies exclusively on injecting fast enough that the pressure that you accumulate is faster than what you can dissipate through the permeability. So the question that we had was recently, but we haven't been able to convince the reviewers that this is that this is worth publishing, is what happens when we change the wetting properties. So I'm going to show you a few videos. They're going to play simultaneously. So
what's W again?
What?
W.
Elevated. So I should define. So this is this scales with injection rate. So we're injecting slowly, faster, much faster. And this is the weight that we put on top of the lid. Okay. So it's a surrogate for the confined distance.
And what is the wetting angle that you were talking about earlier?
Yes. So it is represented here. We are measuring wettability by the contact angle, which measures the angle subtended by a droplet deposited on that substrate. So when I say that this is drainage, what I'm saying is that the fluid that we inject forms this sort of full sphere, right? It wants to stay away from that substrate. So this is the case here. So I direct your attention to, for instance, fast injection rates and low confinement stresses. So we see basically a viscous fingering pattern, but for a fast enough injection rate, we then start to see how the grains start to form conduits and move apart. So now we repeat these experiments, but we change the fluids and everything remains the same. Everything is identical except for the contact angle. So that the fluid that we inject is mildly wetting to the glass beads. Nothing else changes. I mean, clearly, the way in which the fluid penetrates into the medium is very different, right? And these are, again, these are very repeatable experiments. They are not anomalies in any way. You will not be able to avoid this type of pattern at these conditions. So the thinking was, well, if this is what happens at weak inhibition, at strong inhibition, we will just see more of it. So we see the experiments. These are for the low confinement stress. But now, as opposed to what you would expect, perhaps, when you see something entirely different, you don't see any fraction whatsoever, and you just see the fluid that you inject imbibe readily into the medium. And again, the interpretation now is that you're coating the grains and not providing enough sort of support of any kind to sustain a fraction. So the summary could be graphically depicted here. There's a lot of analysis of what we can do. We were using fluorescent particles to measure the deformation in the granular pack, and from that we can get some interesting metrics. I think this summarizes it. Wetting plays a role in fraction and granular material, perhaps as we could have expected. So one of the questions, I'm not going to enter into this, but it's something that we've thought about a little bit, and we've analyze some field data. Does this have anything to do with anything? Does it have anything to do with the real field when you go and drill 2,000 meters and then you just blast the shale and fracture? So dimensional analysis suggests that it could, right? That for shallow deposits of a fine-grained material like shales, you would be under the same conditions for some of these experiments in which wetting plays a big role. So we are...
How shallow is shallow?
Yeah, so shallow can be between 1 and 3 kilometers.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so this is sort of kilometer depth.
What's the avalanche chart?
What is that?
In the lower avalanche.
Oh, I don't know. But in this case, I was careful enough to crop the image so that I give the credit to whoever produced the figure. This doesn't always happen. So this raises an interesting question, because typically we think of fracking as an operation which would just blast material into the rock. But this would suggest maybe there's an opportunity to tune the fluid that we use, the fracking fluid, in ways that we haven't thought of
yet,
by perhaps some by adding agents that can modify its wetting properties. So, and this can be, again, I'm not showing any of the analysis, but theoretical calculations suggest that this could be substantial in the sense of having the ability to frack the medium with orders of magnitude less fluid than otherwise you would need.
You mean if there's no cohesion, then the grains are only held together by friction?
Okay, so this is something that, great point, that remains to be investigated. And this is something that we're doing now. We're starting to sinter, so repeat these experiments by lightly sintering the beads, so as to simulate cementation. And we will see if that cementation will just simply go as a tensile strength in the medium that will go straight, with hard straight into the denominator of the fraction number. If that is the case, then I think that this would translate into rocks with tensile strength. The reason why I think that that is plausible is because at this depth, the tensile strength really contributes very little with respect to the, for instance, the shear strength, which is a fraction of the overburden. Right? So if you take the overburden or the typical least compressive stress, you take that magnitude and then you compare it to the tensile strength of a rock, the tensile strength tends to be only a small fraction. So this is why I think it could carry over to materials that are cement, not just the friction. But we'll have to do the experiment. So while I was addressing that question, you could, I don't know what to say. Whether you should have been listening to me or ignoring what I was saying and looking at the video. So I thought that I would, now discuss something that perhaps is of some relevance to the workshop on regular patterns in biology. I don't know anything about biology, anyway, perhaps this is of, I don't know, at least some tangential interest to some of you. And I don't know if I am being provocative, which I like being. Again, I don't necessarily feel ashamed for being provocative. I'm provocative all the time. But by putting this experiment right next to the map of Africa, I may not be just provocative, I may be delusional. Okay? So if I am delusional, that's fine. I'm not going to take offense if you tell me so. So I want to discuss this instability that I think has become very apparent just by playing this video. And that is that if you let water percolate into a porous medium, typically that percolation process gives rise to these trickles, these fingers, that are very persistent. Mm-hmm. And you can see that even as we move from a coarse sand to a fine sand, locally the width of those features will change, and we understand why that happens. But that doesn't take the instability away in any way. Sometimes you get some local merger of two fingers, but then as soon as you arrive at another coarse sand stratum, then the finger will continue its way as if it had not seen this layer at all. Okay, so in the way in which we started to approach sort of this problem of multi-phase instabilities is through a phase field modeling approach. And I know that some of you are actually experts in this view of phase. The recognition is that interfaces are important and we need to account for them when describing multi-phase flows in porous media. And the key idea was, goes back a long time, at the very least, to the paper by Cannon here in 1958, maybe before, to Van der Waals and whatnot. The idea is to recognize that the free energy of the system should incorporate the presence of interfaces. And then these interfaces, from a sort of practical standpoint, will be modeled as diffuse interfaces. So So that imposes certain requirements on how we simulate the governing equation, but this is the approach that we have. So I could just go ahead and show you some results on the model that we cooked up for this infiltration problem and show you some results. But I just feel that it wouldn't be a reasonable to remain a bit skeptical if I just did that. So I have a few slides here to try to justify what you're going to see next. And again, I will do this very quickly, but I want to infuse some degree of confidence that I'm not making everything up. So the simpler system to investigate this type of models is with a essentially one-dimensional system, a capillary tube, in which we have two fluids and we let them rest, and they will form naturally bubbles and slides. So we want to be able to model that. And then if we blow into this tube, the bubbles will move, and they will be able to model that as well. So, and we would like to do that with a one-dimensional model because this geometry, it is very slender, so it's much longer than it is wider. So immediately we realize that a second order equation is not going to be able to do that. I still remember Howard Stone's question several years ago when I talked about this. I said, but if you have a reaction with a source term, you would be able to arrive at a static configuration, right, that is that will go from 0 to 1 across the domain. So here, you don't remember, but I do, right? I've been waiting for the opportunity. In that we want to have a description in which we have mass conservation, so we don't have sources and sinks as we would have in a diffusion reaction system with source. Okay, so second order equations will not be able to reproduce this behavior in which we have this spreading of a system that stops. So we need something else. And here are some equations. I know that many of you are not overwhelmed by equations and not that very well, but I should describe what these are. But then I won't have time for everything that I want to say. So these are simple systems that describe mass conservation, some sort of potential flow, and then a transport equation for the fraction of each phase. And these equations would be perfectly classical if it were not for just one thing, and that is that this term over here, which reflects the capillary pressure, the difference in pressure across an interface, it is not simply a function of saturation. It is not simply a function of volume. So the capillary pressure here is not just a function of saturation. These are understood as chemical potentials responsible for driving flow, and as such, they are the variational derivatives of a free energy. And this free energy, all I want to say is that it is easy to pose so that it's reasonable. For instance, what we would like to say is, what is the energy of the system if it is filled with one fluid versus the other fluid? And that, in a way, is accounting for the wetting properties of the substrate. So this is telling us that if the system is wet or if it's dry, it will have, in general, different energy states. And I think this is a reasonable thing to, it's not just reasonable, it's a way to capture the wetting properties of the system. And then we have a term that accounts for segregation of those two phases, that accounts for phase separation. And then we account for the dissipative term that is responsible for rendering this system dissipated, thermodynamically stable, which is nothing else than surface tension. So with these ingredients, you end up with a description of these chemical potentials that accounts for the wetting properties of the system and for the surface tension or capillary pressure across an interface. And then you can just simulate the equations. Indeed, you can reproduce the static configurations for the entire range of wetting properties, and you can simulate the dynamics, and indeed, now you reproduce the experimental observation that if you blow harder, then you leave a thicker film adhered to the wall of the capillary tube. So, this is just to say that even for this very, very simple configuration of a capillary tube with two fluid phases, we need some description that goes beyond what is classically used in porous mediums. Now, we can turn the derivatives with respect to x into gradients and divergences, right? And then we simulate, so run, and it, magically we can go from 1D to 2D, and we can simulate now the penetration of a fluid into another inner channel. And one of the things that you notice, for instance, is that wherever the fluid penetrates, this is not uniform in color. Right? So the color scale is denoting the fraction of the gap, even though this is a 2D model, is recognizing that the gap may be fully filled or only partially filled by the gradient fluid. And then we can add a wettability to this description. Right? And you will see here a simulation of a system in which the invading fluid is wetting to the squares, but not wetting to the circles. And there are all kinds of sort of interesting details here. For instance, the formation of long-lived wetting films that would be very important in evaporation processes, for instance. Right? Or we can switch, so now play the movie at the bottom, in which we reverse the wettability, right? And we form the films around the squares, but we immediately coat the circles. Okay, so this can all be captured sort of rather naturally in this type of phase field world. So this is, I think, sort of promising in the sense of phenomenologically we can reproduce a set of behavior, that, you know, that comes from observation. But there was something that empirical or phenomenological about all this, that I feel we resolved to some degree by looking at an even simpler system. And that is how a drop spreads on a flat surface. So, this is the story of my life, and probably the story of some of the lives around here. You don't understand something, and then you look at something simpler, and you still don't understand it, and no. I would like to be able to describe multiphase flow in porous media, porous and fractured media with multiphase, multi-component. And then we end up looking at a droplet spreading on a flat surface, which, again, still has something to teach us, it turns out. So, in this context of pattern formation, I would like to look at this to explain what we learn about this problem in the sense of a system that in which two states can coexist. And that is something that the classic equation of thin films over flat surface do not give you. Coexistence is not allowed with that system. You cannot have dry and wet. You can't. But it's something that we want. We want the droplet to spread and then to stop spreading so that we have this is wet and this is dry in the same system. And this can be worked out. I mean, it really can be worked out from the ground up, recognizing the fact that whenever you have two interfaces that are close enough, that leads to interactions between them, which give rise to the joining pressure components, and the recognition that at the tip of this droplet, the interfaces are never parallel. And you can, we borrowed work that allowed us to account for this extension of this joining pressure in wedges. And in with some geometric approximations, we can recast all of that in a form that is, you can see, for some of you, this will be immediately apparent that this is a nonlinear cantilever type free energy, in which we have a bulk free energy component and an interfacial energy component. So then there are some requirements that you need to impose to sort of close the system, but pictorially, not pictorially, this gives rise to this equation, which is an extension of the thin film equation. But pictorially, I think, is perhaps more interesting. in the classical view, we have just the competition between gravity and capillarity, right? So the gravity component will go with the square of the film thickness. But if we account for interfacial effects, we will have not the disjoint pressure component. If we will have a modification, this is not the scale, but we'll have a modification of that free energy that looks like this. And under the regularization of the higher order term, we can construct a solution, a static solution to this system by the common tangent construction, which, again, I think that now, for many of you, this is now more familiar, right? We have two possible states, a dry state and a wet state that can coexist. And again, this, you can now simulate this. You can solve this equation and you find that the behavior that you observe, so the droplet spreads, so this is the area, the wetted area, so it grows and then it stops growing. And depending on the droplet size, it grows with different scaling law, and this is well understood depending on what the balance between different forces is. And if you zoom in into the advancing contact line, you observe that there are deviations from the static contact angle, and those are well understood experimentally, and this model naturally allows you to reproduce those. Okay, so I'm ran out of time, but I wanted to give this a slight detour as a way to convince you that we're not completely, and it's not completely making it up. So now we use these ideas to model this problem, the problem of infiltration into soil. And there are all kinds of observations in the field. Here, this is from a trench. You can see that the wetting fluid, the water that is percolating down, is doing so in a very streaky way. This is a three-dimensional phenomenon, right? This is very nicely illustrated here for this excavation and these dunes. So after a rainfall event, the wind blows, and the colors that remain are the ones that were wetted. And again, you don't have to do anything fancy. You can take a sandbox and just do what I am doing here. Actually, this is yours truly, many years ago. Letting water trickle through this sandbox. And you can see that even though the sandbox is fairly uniform, and I am not trying to squirt a little bit more water at the exact same place every time. No, I'm not doing that. But this percolation process self-organizes into these gravity fields. Okay. And this is irrespective of whether you have layering in the medium, or even whether you have inclusions. And I think this is important because these fingers can go through a number of these low probability inclusions and survive, but it's not like they're going away. And this cannot be captured with the traditional equation that we use to describe infiltration in the unsaturated soil. So the traditional equation is called Richards equation, and it is stable to infinitesimal and finite perturbations in the front. So I like using the analogy that I just imagine the fundamental equations of fluid mechanics, the Navier-Stokes equations, only gave you laminar flow solutions. Okay. So there would be a wide range of behavior that you would not be able to capture. So this is why I spent some time looking at simpler systems. We can cook up, in just one slide, we can cook up a model that follows these phase field methodology by which we include an interfacial term. And it is, all we're saying is that there is an additional contribution as a result of the fact that we have a macroscopic interface that is advanced. And as a result, we end up with not just a second order equation, but a fourth order equation. And there's some scaling that you can do. I'm not going to really pay attention to that, but I want to touch on now two things very quickly. One is the onset of this instability. So that we can study rigorously. We can take this equation and do a linear stability analysis. So the output from that analysis is a set of curves.
For the boundary conditions?
So for the linear stability analysis, there, so this is simply an initial horizontal front that is far away from any boundary.
From infinite boundary.
Yes, that's right. It's an infinite two-dimensional domain with a horizontal front. So this will tell us what frequencies are excited and will grow over time. And in particular, the apex of this curve will tell us which frequencies favor. And here, I can make a leap of faith based on the observations, and that is that these fingers tend not to interact with each other very much, as you could see. So we can argue, well, the linear stability analysis will actually tell us something about the nonlinear regime. You're often not allowed to do that, but here we're doing it anyway. And then we can compare with observations. So if we compare the finger velocity and the finger width for different infiltration rates, we find a model behavior, well, a behavior from the linear stability analysis that agrees well with experimental observations. And then we can actually simulate the multidimensional version of the equations and find qualitatively as well as quantitatively good agreement with experiments. So with this, I will now wrap it up in an eco-hydrologic context. And this is where, you know, being provocative may turn into being delusional, but you know, bear with me for a moment. This could have, one could speculate that this could have some impacts in eco-hydrology. Why? Well, for one, we have a range of observations, field observations, that call for explaining why the water percolates to great depths, even though climatically that would not be very favored. So, in arid and semi-arid regions, we observe deep-rooted plants. So, those roots have to feed, and of course, there are other alternative explanations, but the explanations have to be found anyway, right, for that to happen. And there's also meteoric recharge, again, once again, in these arid and semi-arid regions. So, one can invoke texture, heterogeneity, but sometimes even that, like in the thick sands of the Kalahari, it's hard to always attribute that observation to texture and heterogeneity in the medium. So how does infiltration get past evaporation zone in those circumstances? So we can try to make predictions in which we couple infiltration with evapotranspiration. This has been done by, this is an effort that has been spearheaded, led by people in this room. We will model this evapotranspiration term perhaps in a simple way, as we will have a spatial component and a dependence on saturation. This is reasonable, right? Because we expect that the evaporation will be higher near the ground surface. And if there's nothing to evaporate, it will not evaporate anything. And there will be some sort of plateau by which, if the medium is completely filled with water or only partially filled with water, it will evaporate the same amount. And this explains this mix. Very successful predictions corroborated by experiments in the lab and in the field that first there's a regime of constant evaporation followed by a fall-off. So we can investigate what the effect is of having some climatic input into these dynamics, described as follows. We have two seasons, for instance, and the wet, so a dry season where it doesn't rain, and a wet season in which we have a series of events. We can simulate the system, and if we simulate the system without the gravity fingering, what we find is that depending on the climatic conditions, we will see that during the dry season, we will be either in a, the medium will be completely dry, or it will be completely wet. So atmosphere completely wet or completely dry, depending on the climatic conditions, with a sharp boundary in between. Okay? So if you are in a region where it rains a lot and not much evaporates, the medium stays wet throughout the year session. That's what happens where I come from in Galicia, the northwest of Spain. Well, but there it rains all the time, so there's no, we cannot talk about too soon. Okay. Whereas if we have an arid climate where the annual precipitation is relatively low and the potential evapotranspiration is high, everything is dry. Okay. So what happens, is this modulated in any way by this gravity fingering phenomenon? So the answer from a modeling point of view is yes. So of course, if it rains a lot, even if we have fingering, everything will be wet. But and if it doesn't rain very much at all, if we're in a very, very high region, even if we get fingering, it will still not get through past the evaporation zone. But the point here is that there's a wide range of climatic conditions under which you will be able to go past the evaporation zone only if you have this unstable infiltration. Okay? So now this climatic view changes from one in which we have a sharp contrast between wet and dry to one in which we have a wide range of climatic conditions in which we can sustain water at depth past the evaporation zone. Okay? So qualitatively, the response of the system can be very different. So we have this a climate filter, and we can look at weather stations anywhere we want. So we looked at the weather stations. So depending on this phase diagram for the compact infiltration case, we can have this distribution of wet and dry. Not entirely surprising, but if we map those stations according to this fingered infiltration view of the world, we will see that wide areas within Africa would, in principle, allow for water to get past the evaporation zone, including areas that are rather arid. So this is what I call the climate filter. Where could this be playing a role according to the climate? And then we can look at the soil. So we can look at the soil atlas of Africa and identify soils that are coarse and and for which this phenomenon is exacerbated. So we can identify arenosols and leptosols and regosols and so on, and we can map them. So now we have two filters. We have the climate filter, which we just discussed, and then we have the soil filter, which areas are sandy enough for this to be to have the potential to change things with respect to compact infiltration. And then we find large swaths in which both filters let this pass. Right? So in particular, we see areas of the savanna ecosystems in which potentially this could be playing a role. So with this I will close and say, could gravity fingering, which is strictly just a hydrodynamic instability, super robust as we saw, but unproven, completely unproven and speculative from a field point of view, could be playing a role in the organization of education for semi-arid regions. So with that, I'll take questions if there are any. Strong opinions. So let me just start with that. But that is an important issue that I think is begging to be looked into, which is the interaction with groups. Because one could make the argument, which I think is very valid. Well, but once the root is there, then the water can percolate through it, right? For instance. So, and that
would... You have fingers following the roots.
Yeah. So, my, again, very naive argument is that perhaps a root would... I mean, what am I... Anyway, you can respond to what I'm just about to say. Why a root would uniformly want to go deeper if there were, no, just naturally, more resources down there. So I think that the possibility of sustaining deeper roots could be related to the sheer ability to deliver water to those depths, independently of the root being the delivery channel. But then I think it's calling for a controlled experiment in which you have bare soil, you reproduce this phenomenon because this is so robust that you really cannot avoid it under the right conditions. And then you plant something with roots that you understand and see perhaps how those two things interact. Okay.
So, what do you think about in terms of spatial scale and persistence of these features? They're obviously new simulations, once they form, they tend to persist. So, do you see that as like a critical aspect of spatial organization, or are these things happening at a fine enough scale that small pattern wouldn't get picked up on in the ecosystem?
So without having any conclusive evidence or even thoughts, I would say the former, meaning that these features, whenever this mechanism is particularly aggressive, those features are too small in my mind to explain the spatial organization of the surface. So this is a mechanism, I think, to deliver the water at depth, not so much as a way to organize the vegetation of the surface.
So that implies also then that although this mechanism requires a fine scale simulation to resolve its dynamics, you could approximate it with a bulk equation that would kind of handle this additional flow?
Yes, absolutely.
Without really messing up any of the spatial?
Absolutely. And this is something that sort of casual conversation with Mike, but he pointed this out. Maybe a bucket model is actually a good representation of the dynamics in this case.
Yes.
I think there was a question here. Yes.
So you're talking about average rainfall in these sensors.
Yes.
Rainfall in African countries can come in massive amounts in short times.
That's a great point, and I feel so bad about not having sort of explored that rigorously. So here, indeed, we characterize the rainfall patterns by this valley seasonality, and then events that are equally spaced and of uniform depth. And this is obviously not the case. So we have explored tangentially the effect of having randomness in the rainfall patterns. And what that does is it will modulate the boundaries of this phase diagram. Okay? So now you have not just these relatively well-defined boundaries between wet all the time and wet only part of the time. Depending on the realization, you will have some sort of a width to these phase transition. But in our early or simple exploration, the qualitative behavior remains. That is, if you have one single event every 2 years, or if you have multiple events of different depths within a year, qualitatively this behavior remains. In some areas, you will have will be able to deliver water past the evaporation zone, and in some areas it will not. So it will be modulated by the stochasticity of the rainfall. Mm. I mean, no doubt about it.
I'm not sure I agree with that.
Interesting. No, because I think this is precisely what. So, what did you agree with?
It's not stochasticity, it's just the shear. I mean, it's just the fact that actually the instantaneous rainfall rate doesn't have to vary. It's more like if you have in air systems one shower. I mean, one shower happening the same amount of water per minute, just happening like twice a year. Well, yes. It could be that in the more wet environment, it's the same showers, but it's happening 20 times a year. And so it doesn't really make, we always get the same application there.
Okay. So what you're saying is that there should be, so for just the mean added percentage is not going to be able to capture that variable.
It's not only.
I agree with. I agree with that. This would be an oversimplification of that climatic parameter. Yes.
I think there were, we'll take two more questions, or maybe three, depending on, but I saw some hands here, but I don't want to go too much longer,
yeah.
So.
Yeah, I apologize that I went over time. Yes.
Simple question about mechanism, but when there's water flowing through like this, to what degree does hydrogen bonding make a difference in terms of whether a fluid can make this gravity phenomena or not? It seems like it would have a great effect, influence on it.
So, hydrogen bonding, at the molecular level, I'm not sure that scale would interact here very much at all. What would have an influence is wettability. So for instance, it is actually well known, well recognized experimentally, that this effect is stronger in hydrophobic sands versus hydrophilic sands. So you could have one of these feedback mechanisms in which, you know, if you are not wetting the entire soil, you become hydrophobic, and that would lead to an exacerbation of this finger in front of that. I don't think that would necessarily have an impact from the molecules. Maybe I'm.
Hydrogen bonding gets, you know, the redwood gets water because of hydrogen bonding, right? The same way the gravity there that will cool.
But I don't know if the scales, because the pore scale for a tree might be very different than the pore scale for a cell.
Well, I had a question, Mike, but I think your answer, Ruben, did also. I was going to say that the, not really a provocation, I think more is a support of the bucket model, where beyond a certain field capacity would have percolation deeper to the deeper layers, which I think you were in agreement with what you find.
Okay, let's thank Ruben one more time.